everyone, and welcome to the GT podcast with me, Gaming Stag, and this guy, Matt.
Hi. I'm not on here often.
No, you're not. Yeah. So we're here to discuss,
as the
title suggests, gaming and tech.
And maybe a bit of cars at the end.
Yeah.
Depends how.
So let's get into it.
Steam killing Greenlight.
See, I'm not sure, but I think it's the right approach because they're going for a more serious.
I mean, if they're gonna go for the more like top end in the way of games, they're gonna need to the way they're planning on doing it. By the way, we'll give you some context. What they're planning on doing is taking out Greenlight and putting on a thing called Steam Direct. And Steam Direct, you pay between $100 and $5,000. This is like the price range they've given. They've not actually said this is how much it's going to cost. They've not gave one specific price, but they're saying between them is how much it'll be to post the game on Steam, and it won't go through this green lighting process that it currently does, where currently you, if you don't know how it works, you go on the green light page, you'll download a game, and you'll try it out, and then you'll green light it if you like it. If you don't, you'll just. What is it you do when you don't?
I think there's a dislike, I think, as well. Dislike.
Right. Okay. We'll leave that in, because screw it. But yeah, like, I mean, it is a bit of a bad thing. Like, if you're an indie developer and you're looking for your game to be greenlit, I've seen games taking months to get greenlit.
Yeah.
And that's, like, really daunting on the developer, because they think, oh, am I good enough? Like, it's this like mindset they get them put into, and it's not right on the developer, but it's a good idea to do it this way with the Steam Direct, because it's a lot quicker.
Yeah, I mean,
less pressure.
I know somebody in a Facebook group, YouTube gaming community, shout out to you guys, you know, Tears of Dragon went through Greenlight last year. Very impressed with it, you know.
I've not tried it.
No, it's. I've seen it, and I've seen people do it in that group. Just have a go at it on YouTube. It's. I really like it. It's got that Pokemon feel that you have for it, but it's different. It's more, you know, medieval kind of stuff.
It's quite fun.
It's interesting.
I'll have to try that.
Yeah.
But what they say in the quote from some guy, which doesn't say, I apologize for that. If I can find quotes with names, I will give names. If somebody knows who this is, tell me, please. So what they said is, the next step in these improvements is to establish a new direct sign-up system for developers to put their games on Steam. This new path, which we're calling Steam Direct, is targeted for spring 2017, which is like, now, and will replace Steam Greenlight. We will ask new developers to complete a set of digital paperwork, personal or company verification, and tax documents similar to the process for applying for a bank account. Once set up, developers will pay a recoupable application fee for each new title they wish to distribute, which is intended to decrease the noise in submission pipeline. I think that's a good idea, because they will be getting a lot of people going, like, oh, be a tree simulator.
Yeah, I saw Rock Simulator. Yeah, that's a thing.
Rock Simulator.
Rock Simulator's a thing.
Did that not get greenlit?
I think it did as well.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But it'll replace stuff like your Rock Simulator with stuff that's actually,
you know,
okay.
Stupid stuff like that. It's like, why would you?
It's probably just like a video of people walking past you and stepping on you. I wonder if it's VR. Anyway, back to the quote. While we have invested heavily in our content pipeline and personalised store, we're still debating the publishing fee for Steam Direct. We talked to several developers and studios about an appropriate fee, and they give us a range of responses from as low as $100 to as high as $5,000. There are pros and cons at either end of the spectrum, so we'd like to gather more feedback before settling on a number. I think that's a sensible idea.
Yeah, the fact that they do kind of paperwork as well. It's more of like the workplace, how the actual gaming industry works.
Not that it has to be like the workplace, but it's a more professional way to go about it, and it's a better way for them to like put tags on things. Because I've seen things that are like put down as, what was it I saw the other day? There was something with a completely unrelated tag, and it was ridiculous. And there was like one other game under that tag, and it was something that I wanted to look for. And then there was the other one, which was like nothing to do with it.
Mm.
I think I said simulator and it come up with some crap. Anyway, whatever it was,
it will hopefully get
resolved with this new paperwork way that they're doing it. Speaking of paperwork and things, that was a crap segue. Asus have announced two new X370 boards, the ROG Crosshair 6 Hero and the X370 Prime. Now, I've not read that beforehand and I probably should have, but they have unveiled two high-end AM4 boards. I run Intel personally, and so
does... So does he.
But this, I'm not gonna lie, I'm quite excited for it.
In terms of the aesthetics, it looks very, very nice.
I would, if it come with an Intel socket, I said before we started recording, if it comes with an Intel socket, I would have that in a heartbeat.
Yeah. And the amount of USB slots there
are. Oh, it's ridiculous. Things
like that,
we'll put a picture up, like, here. Just the whole screen, right? Wherever it comes up, there's a picture. Look at the amount of USB 3.0 on that thing.
I know.
I run an Oculus Rift and I got an extra USB card in my computer, and I have a Asus Maximus 8 Hero, which is a really decent motherboard, and it doesn't have many USB 3.0, but I still need to use a Type-C.
Yeah.
I'm planning on getting pendrive for that because I want to utilize it. But these two, the Crosshair 6 Hero features the high-end Supreme FX audio, which I can tell you personally is actually, like, from personal experience, it's actually really good. Like, the tools they provide with it, like this, what's it called, Sonic Studio?
Yeah.
It's actually pretty good. I tried it out last night, because I've just put a preamp on my mic and stuff now, so I thought I might as well try the inbuilt one on the motherboard, because I've never tried that. I've always run through.
I think they're always compatible with the Fanatics RGB lighting as well, so that's good as well.
Yeah, they've got two LED headers on the motherboard.
Yeah.
Which is incredible, because like, I've run LED strips before, and running LED strips when they're not sunk with a computer, it looks crap. Like, my computer currently, I've got a GTX 1080, and I've got red lighting all around my computer. But the GTX 1080, it's like a Founders Edition, so it has a big green light on it. When you have lights that are a different colour in the case, it doesn't look right. In this case, it's okay. But
I presume that's the reason why they turned mine off, because I ordered blue LED lighting on the corner.
If you got green, they probably would.
Yeah.
But my LEDs are so, so dim. It's ridiculous. That's them on full bright.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to this Crosshair Hero. It's got built-in Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
Is my thoughts.
Well, it depends, really.
It does. It depends. Like, it's good in some cases.
Because some people will have an Ethernet and some people won't have access to them.
Well, thinking about it, it's probably a good thing, and I think more motherboards should come with Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
But I think they should try and push the Ethernet.
I think it's for those people that, you know, are doing portable gaming.
Since when is like a full ATX motherboard portable?
Well, they might bring out a mini, you never know.
A mini?
Mini ATX.
Oh, a mini! I thought it meant like a car! I was gonna say, that's
no,
later.
No.
Save it for later. Anyway, it's got M.2 and USB 3.1 support. I use M.2. Thumbs, big thumbs up from me. Until it breaks. Big thumbs up from me.
How many times did I install my operating system?
At least three.
Do you want to know how many it actually was?
It was 7, wasn't it?
12.
Really? 12? 12. Wow.
And on the server, it's been 4. But that's because I've screwed it up.
Yeah.
That was my fault. It's nothing to do with the drives. And most of the times on my computer, it's my fault too. But by the by, there's no rear display I/O from the looks of it. I don't get why they've put Wi-Fi on it, but no rear display I/O. Like, okay, they're not related. But if you're not gonna have Ethernet running to your computer, are you gonna be able to afford? Like, I'm not saying that everybody that runs Wi-Fi is poor. You could just buy a Wi-Fi card. Like, a really decent one. For, like, cheap. And then they could knock money off the motherboard. Because people will be buying graphics cards with this.
Mm.
Like, fair enough if it's to save money for those graphics cards, but that's not the point. Like, if you're going to be buying a graphics card and you need Wi-Fi, just buy a Wi-Fi card too.
Yeah.
It's not that big of a difference. They're like 20 quid. Like, if you go on Amazon US, they're like, you can get some cheap ones for like 10 bucks.
Yeah.
Which is ridiculously cheap. I have cards under my bloody bed which are like USB and FireWire and stuff that cost more than that. Like, that's cheap. Anyway, RGB light and 2 LED headers. Wait, this is taking so much longer than I thought it would. 2-way SLI.
Yeah.
And 3-way crossfire.
Yeah.
2-way SLI, well, that's all you're gonna support from now. So,
yeah.
People with wanting 4. Unless, you can.
Unless you're Dead Mouse and have like 4 Titan X's, you know?
But the XP's.
It's the old one, I'm not sure.
But, you can have more than 2. Maybe not in this, but you can. Yeah.
Other than
I'm not saying you totally can't, but you can. But it's a pain because you need to go through NVIDIA and get, what is it called? The Enthusiast Key or something.
Something like that, yeah.
And you need to get that thing and register for crap. Yeah. And the next thing it has is auto and manual overclocking support. Manual, yes. Auto, just scrap it.
Yeah.
Like, I've tried the auto overclocking and it is awful. My computer blue screens straight away.
Wow.
Like, I don't go near it. Like, if you're planning on overclocking slightly, just move the slider. It's not hard.
Mm.
You don't need to put your voltage up or anything if you're just doing, like, a tiny bit. But go on YouTube, there's guides. Look up your motherboard on YouTube, an overclocking guide. They're there. There's hundreds of them. Thousands of them.
Even in the motherboard manual as well, probably.
Do you know what? I haven't checked. Is my manual in here? No, my manual's upstairs. Anyway, moving on to the Prime. The Prime has isolated audio, which isn't as high-end as the Supreme FX. M.2 and USB 3.1.
Yep.
Thumbs up again.
Definitely.
RGB lighting and 1 LED header. I think 1's enough.
Yeah.
You can fit 10 meters worth of strips on 1 header.
Yeah. Definitely.
I assume, because that's what you can usually do. 2-way SLI, 3-way crossfire, auto and manual overclocking support. Yeah. It's got like the monochrome look of it. I really like it. I like the heat spreader over the flash.
Yeah, definitely.
Like, that looks so nice.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's got all the usual crap.
Yeah.
That nobody ever uses. Oh! I didn't see that. Is that the LEDs on it?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't know what that is. That is not the same motherboard. The resolution's too crap to see it. Anyway, that's it for the motherboards.
Yep.
And I forgot to open the next page.
Ryzen is going to have twice as much L2 cache as Intel's high-end.
Yeah. There has been some sort leaked benchmarks as well, but the fact that it's more for hyper-threading, it's better than the newest Intel i7, but it's really crap for gaming.
Right, they say here, it'll offer twice as much level 2 cache. But does that mean that they've merged level 2 and level 3? Because that isn't unheard of for them to do that. Say, oh, we've got all this level 2 cache. And it's like, yeah, but it's level 2 and level 3. If you're unaware of what level 2 and level 3 cache is, I didn't do a video on it. I did a level 1 video. Level 2 cache is... Do you know what? I can't remember off the top of my head.
We want to wait till it's out before we do it on the leaked benchmarks, as I just mentioned, you know.
Yeah. Like, we don't... I'm not going to mention any benchmarks today. Like, I've seen benchmarks, but I'm not going to mention them. Because I don't want to be the one that people are going to turn around and go, you got it wrong. You're to blame.
Because it is leaked, after all.
Exactly. Leaked doesn't mean final. And that means that's the same with everything. Leaked is never the final. Well, it might be. Like, they were pretty good with
It's essentially a rumor, really.
They were good with the GTX 1080.
Yeah.
I wonder if the 1080 Ti will be right, because that's
Because that looked promising, definitely.
Like, that's on my wish list.
Yeah.
Like, that might get replaced. I'm not even kidding.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, Ryzen early. Early March launch, so.
Yeah.
Soon.
Very, very soon.
Depending on when you're watching this video. It might already be out. You might be watching this in a Ryzen processor. If so, get your hose.
We kid, of course.
I've not seen the temperatures yet. I really want to see the temps. That's one thing I want to see. Yeah. Should we talk about this?
Yeah. E3 has now opened its doors to the public.
Do you know, I never saw that bit. I never knew it was public.
Yeah.
Oh.
I thought you read it properly.
No, I didn't.
No, no.
I've read nothing.
But the tickets are expensive. I'm talking...
300. They started off at 150.
Yeah.
I'm just reading this off here.
$300.
The 250, sorry.
Yeah.
That's...
I mean, it is E3. It's the biggest one.
It's okay.
It's the big boy.
It's for being E3.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna lie, that ticket price is actually okay. I would probably pay that.
Yeah, and the thing is, UK...
Where is it?
We've got tickets as well.
LA.
Plane tickets as well.
When? Oh, I can't go.
So, it's gonna be more expensive for Europeans, but, you know.
Yeah, but...
It's at the end of the day, it will be worth it.
I noticed for TwitchCon being such a small... kind of event at the beginning.
Yeah.
It was so busy.
Yeah.
Like, it's quite a... If any of you've been to Moscow and West, you'll know that it's quite a weird convention center in the way that it isn't like one big floor space.
Mm.
It's like, remember our old school hall?
Yeah.
It's like the size of that times like two or three.
Right, yeah.
On top of each other.
Alright, yeah.
In like, is it three or four floors? I think it's four. Because the top floor was the theatre. Then they had... No, it was three. Top floor was theatre. Then they had like the Amazon and stuff. A big like LAN thing.
Yeah.
And then they had the main show floor.
Yeah. So when we say our old school hall, we can say kind of indoor basketball sized.
Well, like say four badminton courts sideways.
Yeah.
Say like four badminton courts sideways and across. That's Well, four badminton courts like lengthways, like that.
and then like one in width.
Yeah.
So put four of them together.
And that's the size we're talking
that's
about.
That's like the size I'm talking about. So that's pretty small.
Yeah.
But it was so busy. But
I was surprised the amount of people when I went to EGX for the first time in 2015. It was.
Do you know the one good thing about TwitchCon? Not many, like, normal people go. I say normal people as if everybody's, like, really weird. But not many, like. Viewers. Not many viewers go.
Mm.
So it's all people that are, like. I spent, what? Half an hour to an hour with Martin in the Little Wood.
Mm.
And then there's like, who else? Sorn. I spent ages with him.
Yeah.
Like the Mindcrack crew. If you go on YouTube and look at them, they're pretty big.
Yeah.
How long did I spend? Like, I spent like 2 hours with them.
Yeah.
Not even like. It was ridiculous how easy it was. Like BTC, I spent like half an hour with him.
Yeah.
No problem.
Mm. I think it's the same one, the one that's in Sydney. It's really recently, I can't remember what it's called. Muzak went to it. So he's definitely pretty big. So.
Do you know, we should probably be talking about E3. Do we know who's going to the
E3? No. EA are definitely going with their EA Play. I think that's all that's been confirmed.
Ooh, I'll need to look that up later.
So we're going to be expecting, obviously, the next FIFA, Mass Effect Andromeda is probably going to be there as well. The new Star Wars Battlefront 2, which I'm very excited
about. Is that going?
I believe it's this year they're coming for it.
Oh,
they're adding campaign. They are adding campaign, which I'm really happy about. Now, most people, when you say Star Wars Battlefront, it's a bit of a crap show.
Multiplayer thing.
You know, it's and everyone's disappointed coming from, you know, the old guys, Visceral, but you know, from their Star Wars Battlefront 2, and then they rebooted it, and then everyone's given it stick. And I actually quite liked it. It's very fun because it's got so much in multiplayer. So,
I really want to talk about this because this.
Yeah.
I'm going there in like.
Yeah.
4 weeks, 3 weeks. So. Speaking of E3.
Speaking of US.
US in general. Before entering the US to go to E3 or whatever, travelers may have to provide their social media passwords.
Yeah.
I'm not okay with that. Like, I've done nothing wrong with social media.
Yeah.
And if they want to scan my social media, if they had some sort of tool where they could go on my social media and see my private posts without having to sign in or like see my messages and stuff, I'm okay with that. I'm not okay with them having my password, however.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people use the same password for multiple things. I don't, really. So, in that way, I'm kind of okay with it. Like, if they have my password, they'd not be able to get into much.
Hmm.
But, in that sense, there's a lot of people that have the same password for everything.
Yeah.
And that. Like, I know somebody that the other day, they had one of their accounts compromised, so I told them to change all the accounts with that password and that email. Do you know how many accounts I had to change? 28.
Oof.
And so, I don't, like, that's bad. If they have, details for 28 accounts, that's...
Because some people do that,
that's too much. But it was saying here, there's, somebody was stopped and, like, they wouldn't get let through until they, like, handed over their phones. But even then, there was, like, 45 minutes of being, like, interrogated. Yeah. And then they got turned away because, like, they were Muslim.
Mm.
So they got turned away.
Yeah.
So that's ridiculous. But that's just...
This is the new...
Let's not get political about this. Let's not get political about this. This is the new rules in the US. No more political.
Yeah.
That's it for Politicon. Anyway, let's move on to a very, very quick 10-minute cars.
Yeah.
Talk. You were talking about SUVs earlier.
I was. A lot of car manufacturers are now going through the SUV because it is more the trend now. You know, my parents were saying to me when I brought this up to them, because they're into cars and stuff, and I'm like, yeah, okay. It would have been saloons and stuff like that at their time. Today, it's SUVs. We're seeing a Mitsubishi crossover in the new announcement in March 7th. BMW have a new one. Audi have the new Q8. Jaguar F-Pace, of course.
There's a new... I was in a Volkswagen dealership earlier today.
Yeah.
I just bought a new car, so... I was in the Volkswagen dealership. There's a new Tiguan as well.
Yeah. Yeah, there is one of those.
It's not bad.
Rolls-Royce! You heard me right. Rolls-Royce are doing
one. I need to see this.
I have seen it. I have, yes.
Is it nice?
I've only seen a brief picture, but it's alright. But the
A brief picture?
Yeah.
They like flash up on your screen. And
well, I looked at it briefly, then I scored off it, because I was like, okay.
Sure.
But, yeah, Mitsubishi, the Eclipse crossover, you know, is...
That is disgusting.
Do you know why they put that paint job on?
Why?
To hide the markings before release. They do, every single car manufacturer does that on purpose.
Hide the markings?
Like the lines and stuff before it's actually released to the public.
You know those cars you used to draw when you were six?
Yeah.
And you were like, this looks cool. But you had your pencil like that in your hand and you were like stabbing the paper. Yeah, it looks like that. Yeah. Very, very boxy. Anyway, I bought a car.
Yeah, you did.
And it's a nice one. You've not seen it.
No, I haven't
seen it. In person.
No.
Have you seen the pictures?
Yes, I have.
It's a Volkswagen Polo Match Edition of course, 2017.
Of course, when he showed me that it was a VW, I had to make the CO2 emissions joke.
Of course.
Yes.
Forgot about that.
Yeah.
But the CO2 emissions have been fixed.
Yes.
And it's actually really good. Car tax on it is cheap. Mine right now is, I can't actually remember, because I've not paid it for a long time. Not meaning like tax evasion, like the last time I paid it was like ages ago and I've not had to pay it again yet. But first year's free, and this is before the new tax laws.
Yeah.
First year's free, how much do you reckon for the second year? £20.
Huh?
£20. That's it.
Wow. That's cheap. Yeah. One more thing before we wrap this podcast up.
I don't know what this is. Now, is it about the Dacia Sandero?
No.
Talk your quote. No. Do you remember that episode?
Yes.
Now for the news. Good news. What?
In terms of handsets coming out in 2017, it was time for me to upgrade mine. Now, I might have done a first impressions...
I'm going to take it out of the back of my phone because it's got private information on it.
...of the Samsung Galaxy A5 2017, which is exactly what I upgraded from. Which is right here.
Take it out of the case.
I'm going to take it out of the case, yeah?
just
check it out. And so I've come from a Windows phone, so I'm very pleased with mine.
I come from a Windows phone as well.
Yeah.
And I upgraded first to iPhone 6, and then I got fed up of it. So I bought this.
Yeah, iPhone 7.
iPhone 7.
What's this? Headphone jack.
Oh no, they're useless. I've got jaybirds, they're useless.
This is the Samsung Galaxy A5 2017.
And this is no headphone jack.
Yes. And I can tell you, we're going to do a little review now. Just a few minutes. Because...
We are.
Let's admit it. I did my first impressions. I said I'd do it. So let's tag it on to the podcast. So... In terms of design, it's very similar to the S7. But you might think, why would I buy this?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, very similar size.
If anybody has held like an iPhone 6 or an iPhone 7 or an iPhone 6S, not the Plus models, it's very similar in size. Yeah. Like, I noticed that. Do you know what else is very similar?
The thickness, yeah.
The thickness, not only that, but the button layout.
Yeah.
What about the camera position? Oh, your camera's right in the middle.
Yeah. Nah. So, the only thing I love about the design...
It's a Type C.
It is a Type C, that's right. I love the rounded corners because I don't like sharp corners because they catch you and it's iffy, you know? So, let's have a little tour. It does have the display, if I can do it the right way, yeah? The always-on display, which has come from the S7. This is a mid-budget phone. I wouldn't pay any more because this has so much stuff in it that, you know, you'd find a flagship phone.
How much is that compared to the Pixel?
Pixel's around, I would say, 30 a month. This is around, I'm paying 26 a month.
That's okay.
Yeah, for a mid-budget phone. At the bottom, we have a headphone jack. Apple users are sadly missing.
What's that? I've never heard of that before.
A Type-C USB.
The camera's there, not like there.
I don't know why I was doing it that way.
It's like over here. Look at that.
Yeah, it's over here. Right, yeah. We have the...
Look at that. How cool is that? You're messing out.
The double layout of the volume buttons, and I like that instead of one button, you know it's going to be up or down. Yeah, that's definite.
You can feel the gap between.
What I haven't actually experienced is before in a phone is using a pin.
Quick review.
Yes, we are doing a quick review. A5 2017.
Outtakes reel come in to explain why.
Could I interest you in some Thornton's cookies and cream white chocolate creamy crunch, net weight 90 grams? I'm too scared to try it first, so that's why I'm asking if you want to.
So, as you can see, it has the always on display.
Oh, I can see.
yeah, without the glasses, you know.
You do realise that autofocus isn't on, so when you do that, it's probably out of focus.
Well, coming from the S7, a lot of features come from this into this brand new device. It has Type-C on the bottom. It has the 2 volume. It has fingerprint, which I
That's
love.
That's so useful. I use fingerprint all the time. It's like that. It's almost like a burden when you have to type in 4 digits now.
Camera, yep. Headphone jack, which you're missing out on, yep.
I've got 2 speakers on the bottom.
The speakers have been moved to up the side. And I know why Samsung have done that. When you're watching a YouTube video, your hand isn't blocking it. Very clever idea.
But, when you're watching a YouTube video,
or playing a game,
I tend to hold my phone like this. That blocks the speaker. Well done, Samsung. You've screwed up. Put it like more in the middle. Because you're going for mono audio with that, and I know you are. Unlike Apple. That's a speaker, which you don't go like that.
Yeah.
And there's 2 speakers on the bottom, which you do cover, I'll admit. But it doesn't make too much of a difference.
Yeah, but in terms of design, it's very, very stylish. Now, if we move on to performance and all that kind of stuff, specs will be on screen right now. It's good. It has that really kicking in processor. It has 3 gigs of RAM, you know, which I'm really pleased with. And the camera, 16 megapixel camera.
Mine's 12.
In a phone.
So yours does 4K?
Yeah, I believe so, yeah.
I'm actually quite, how many FPS does yours do?
I honestly cannot remember, because I haven't tested it thoroughly yet.
720p. Mm-hmm. 240 FPS.
Nice. So the performance is there. It's definitely there. When I'm playing Real Racing 3, Need for Speed No Limits, Angry Birds.
Oh, Angry Birds, you need all the processing power.
Yeah, all the processing's bad. No lag whatsoever.
I need one of those motherboards we were talking about earlier.
Yeah, and one of the fantastic features is you can record gameplay on your phone. It's a thing. through Samsung. It's fantastic. He's just gonna, he's Googling it.
I have to look at that, so that Rolls Royce again.
So yeah, it's
this thing I can do, and I can't look it up on my iPad because it's...
And it can do it in 1080p, which is fantastic, recording on this 1080p mobile games, you know?
Here's another thing. He has a 1080p screen.
Yeah. 1920 by 1080.
I don't.
Completely high definition.
I don't. Mine's less than 1080. Mine's like 1200. Yeah. And except that, like that's...
Yeah.
I think that's like... just lower than 4K.
And in terms of battery life, it will last you the entire day. It has a 3000 milliamp battery.
Milliamp hour.
That's what I said, but yeah.
You said milliamp. A milliamp hour.
Yes.
Remember your engineering.
Yes. Anyway, it is very good. It will last you the entire day. With general usage gaming, you might need to charge it throughout the day, but I can last from around 9.
Just take like a small portable charger with you. I carry around
9 till around 5 o'clock, I get to 30 to 40%.
I carry around a 5,600 milliamp hour battery with me, and I can go through that and my phone.
Yeah. So it's a solid phone. It is really the solid phone. The two criticisms I have is on the back, fingerprints and marks and scuffs will start to appear, and that is a bit, you know,
I agree.
Ruining.
So it's the same it's the same with a matte finish. And when you've got grease on it,
when you're
so
recording footage, you can't flip the camera partway through, which is a bit annoying because you've got to
know if you can with the iPhone either.
No. I think it's a feature that they need because I was doing a...
You can't.
Yeah.
I've got a video now of me saying you can't.
Yeah.
If you notice, the light's different. The light died in our car.
Hmm.
Because my sister's fault.
Yeah, well, anyway, I was recording a behind the scenes, my setup, and I was doing a vlog, and then I had to flip around, so I had to stop recording, starting.
I noticed that too. You have to stop and be right back.
Yeah, it's like, you'll cut it, but you know, it's a little bit annoying if you just want to do it in like 10, 15 minutes.
It's time consuming, especially with editing at the end as well. You need to cut everything together and make sure it's smooth.
But honestly, this is a very, very solid device, and I love it. I really do. And there is a rumor with the S8, in fact.
Is it better than the Windows Phone?
Of course it is.
Mine's in the other room. I still haven't put a hammer through it yet.
Apparently, they're removing this thing here, the button.
It's the same with the iPhone 8. They're removing the button. They've already put one step towards it with the solid state. Have you tried the solid state?
No. Wow.
It's weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
They've already went towards it with the solid state, but they're planning on removing the button altogether and integrating the Touch ID with the screen.
Yeah, that's the same with Samsung as well. So.
But yeah.
Yeah, that's how it's all progressing, eh? Yeah. So that's all we have time for today. I hope you enjoyed it, and we will be seeing you in the next one.
Bye.